Good morning, everyone. Get ready to be amazed by our first speaker of the day. He's actually the longest serving speaker for Young America's Foundation. You may not believe it, but I had the incredible luck of hearing him speak at my very first YAF conference as a high schooler. During that speech, I realized the fascinating nature of history and how being an engaging and interactive teacher can significantly impact students' learning experiences. And believe me, he is definitely energetic and passionate about what he teaches. Our speaker has been a college professor at many places, especially Hillsdale College in Michigan, where he still serves as a distinguished fellow. He has written 10 books. These books include The Myth of the Robber Barons, which is published by Young America's Foundation. He has also written New Deal or Raw Deal, which describes FDR's disastrous New Deal program, which attacked free enterprise and slowed down America's recovery from the Great Depression of the 1930s. He received his PhD in history from the University of Pittsburgh, and he appears regularly on Fox News. Today, it is a true honor for me to introduce you all to the one and only Dr. Burt Folsom.
Thank you. Oh. I've been hearing nothing but good things about you people today. You've just done a really good job, and it's exciting to be here. I have an extremely important topic to be discussing in history. By the way, how many of you sort of like history? Oh, good. Several. Quite a few. Okay. I would say in the issue of American history, there may only be one or two other questions that are as important in this question that I'm going to address today in understanding American history. In other words, this is probably one of the three or so most important questions that can be asked. And it's rarely asked, and it's rarely presented in the classroom, which is why I'm glad to be here with you. The question is this: how did the United States go from being a mediocre country on the world scene to being the number one powerhouse economically in the world? It's an obvious question. Well, I mean, when George Washington and the founders put our country together, we just barely were able to get by Great Britain. And the only reason we did in the Revolutionary War is they kind of ran out of gas and they got tired of supporting the war. We didn't have a navy. We had an army that was very weak. And then as we go through the first 80 or so years of our history, every time we'd have a good invention, like we invented the telegraph and we invented steamships and all that technology, we'd end up having other countries come along, and especially in steamships, and do it better than we did. So by the time you get to the 1860s, the Civil War, the United States really is a second-rate nation. Yet we know that it was a major power. I lost my water. We know that it was a major power, the United States, by the 1900s. The question then is, let me put this over here. The question is, how did it happen from after the Civil War, 1865, to about 1905, about a 40-year period, the United States go from being way down here to way up here? One of the key dates in this, and by the way, I'm glad to have our board on here, because I can draw. I like to draw a map. In fact, I'm going to draw a map in a minute of the United States. The key date that starts the American thinking in the right direction on greatness is May 10th, 1869. On that day, we completed the Transcontinental Railroad, the Union Pacific and the Central Pacific. Let me draw a map and let me explain. I like drawing. How many, map drawing? Can some of you try drawing the United States? It's always interesting. I'm making California here. There, California, Texas, Florida, Now, here's my best part that I'm best at, is the Canadian border. There, United States! Now, we're talking about a transcontinental railroad. We had railroads in the east, but here in Omaha, we started to go west out to California with the Union Pacific Railroad, and the Union Pacific was supposed to go this way, and the Central Pacific was supposed to go that way. So, and then they're gonna meet. And they met in 1869, and you think, well, wasn't that a good thing? The answer is no, it wasn't. And it changed the direction of American thinking. It wasn't a good thing because the incentives were all out of whack. The government was funding the railroad. The United States tended to look at a problem and say, oh, we lag behind Great Britain. We lag behind France and the Germans. Therefore, we ought to get the government in. See, we're down here, they're up there. So if we get the government in to help us start a business, then maybe we can get up there and catch up and then maybe turn it over to free enterprise. Instead, we were taxing people and putting the government in charge, and we had subsidies to the Union Pacific, I'll put it here, UP, Union Pacific, and subsidies to the Central Pacific. We paid more in subsidies to those two railroads than the entire national debt in 1860. I mean, we just paid a huge amount, millions and millions of dollars. I'll do this. Sometimes you have railroad tracks that are done like that. Now, what I'm not drawing correctly here, among other things, is that the Union Pacific, they're paying by the mile. They're being paid by the mile to build that. The railroad, I have it kind of looking, right, because you're going out to California. You're being paid by the mile. Every mile, they just build out. But the railroad began to look a little bit like this, moving the Union Pacific moving west. Do you see what I mean, paid by the mile? You get that? Oh, we're being paid by the mile. Well, let's kind of move it out a little bit like, now I'm exaggerating a little bit, but do you see that? Then we get more miles. Now I ask you, is a railroad built like that likely to be an efficient railroad for delivering goods and people from east to west? It was a disaster. It had to be completely rebuilt after this. It was a total failure. What's more, a man named James J. Hill came along and said, that is such a big failure, I'm gonna build one from St. Paul, Minnesota. I mean, we think it gets cold in northern Illinois. You get up there to St. Paul, Minnesota. And I'm gonna build one across to Seattle. And I'm gonna do no federal subsidy. I'm gonna do it without any subsidy. People thought that's impossible. You can't build a railroad across there without getting some help from the government. And he said, yes, I can. And he did. And what's more, James J. Hill, he never went to college. He had, he lost an eye, his right eye. He was a kid playing with a bow and arrow. And bing, somebody hit him in the right eye. You know, so the guy was even handicapped. And he comes in there and raises the money and makes the exports of the area, the farming, the copper, the trees with the lumber. He ends up getting exporters in there and just shipping goods back and forth and ends up making this perhaps the most, it's called the Great Northern Railroad. It's now part of the Burlington Northern Railroad. The most efficient railroad in the United States. So what we have here, get this. We pay more than the entire national debt worth of money to this railroad. We pay nothing to this railroad, and they have the best railroad in the country. I wonder if there is a lesson to be learned here. We sat down and thought, I don't know if the United States is ever going to catch the other countries. We're down here, and they're still up here. But we're going to try to narrow that gap and move up through free enterprise and not by giving somebody a subsidy. In fact, just to make sure that they did it this way, we had the income tax. We abolished the income tax. I mean, isn't it exciting to see Congress kind of learning something? I mean, they did back then anyway. And so what you have is a situation that we abolished in 1872, the income tax. So the point is you abolish the income tax so nobody can come in and say, oh, we need to give somebody else a huge subsidy here. We need to give Steve Jobs a subsidy to invent the iPhone. You know, you can't do that anymore because we took away the income tax. So now we have a situation, we are trusting free enterprise. The theory that we had is freedom works. Freedom works. Government payment and subsidies of people distort the incentives and they don't work. You distort the incentives. You give somebody an incentive, they don't have an incentive to complete the project, they have an incentive to keep it going and not do it efficiently. We are going to turn entrepreneurs loose. I don't know who's going to do it. I don't know what they're going to invent. But for the next generation, that's what we're going to try. You know, let's do something kind of fun. They've told me you're such a good group. The group over here, well, first of all, I'll just say, freedom works.
Freedom works.
Let me hear again.
Freedom works.
Let me try this group from here, in the middle line, all the way back. Your freedom and your works. So if I point to you, that's what I like to hear. That's what we're trying. That's still a hypothesis. We don't know if it really will work. That's what we're trying as a nation. What we have in that 40-year period, we start out with a series of inventions and people say, I wonder if this is really going to go anywhere. For example, shortly after this transcontinental disaster, a guy named Christopher Sholes from the Midwest, from Wisconsin, invents the typewriter. He had the system, you know, with the typewriter, the Q-W-E-R-T-Y, they sometimes call it QWERTY, the keyboard that we have. He invented the keyboard, the typewriter, and that invention was done, an American invention. And so we're off and going. Because we all know letter writing and all this. It makes business more efficient. You can type letters and mail them, and it's more readable and it's quicker. So that's a start. Okay, we got it started. Then, in the 1880s, we had the invention of the adding machine. The adding machine. I mean, one guy looked at it, I thought, well, we always had an adding machine, right? No, we didn't. We didn't have an adding machine. Corporations, up until the 1880s, had to get all of their ledgers in their bookkeeping and add every transaction. We didn't have very many accounting majors back then. I wouldn't want to be an accounting major. There was a guy who worked for a bank named William Burroughs, and he said, I hate adding all these things. Somebody makes a deposit, and then if somebody makes a mistake, people freak out. I thought I had $10,000 in my account. Oh, excuse me, we made an error here. You only have $1,000. You know, so you have the adding machine absolutely makes business so much more efficient. It's an American invention. William Burroughs from St. Louis invents the adding machine. Then we have this one, and I have I want to show you how it works. We have the invention of the computer. The invention of the computer. Exciting. The invention of the computer. It was done by a guy named Herman Hollerith. Herman Hollerith was dating a girl named Kate Billings, and he wanted to impress Kate. And so he went to a picnic. They went to a picnic together, and he was trying to make a good impression. And Kate Billings, guys, we give him credit. There was a lottery going on, and there was cookware and all sorts of pots and pans, things that she wanted that were the prize in the lottery. And he got the, you know, guys, we sometimes get the idea, hey, I ought to try to win that lottery for my girlfriend. You know, sometimes stuff sinks through and we get it. And this was one of those instances. He got it. And so he bought, once he realized what was going on, he bought every lottery ticket. Wasn't that clever? He bought every lottery ticket. And then they came out to call the winner, and it was one ticket that was bought before he got there was the one that won, and he lost. And he was, and I would be the same way. I mean, just totally depressed. You know, not only did I not win the cookware and all that stuff, but I lost all my money, and I barely have enough to get home and to get Kate home, and she'll probably never want to see me again. And Kate felt so sorry for him. She said, "You come over to dinner. I want you to meet my dad, and I will cook the dinner, and you won't have to do anything." And so they got over, and she met her dad, and her dad was in charge of the U.S. Census. And we had a population of 50 million people back in 1880, from 1880 to 1890. And he said, he was talking with Herman, and he said, because Herman was studying engineering, and he said, "What we need is someone who can figure out, because we have to hand tabulate every piece of data for 50 million people in the census, and it's taking us 10 years to do that. And in 1890, 10 years later, we anticipate the census numbers to be 60 million. Turned out to be 62 million. And so if it takes us 10 years to tabulate by hand all the information for the 1880 census, think what it's going to be like for the 1890. And so Herman said, you know, Kate was saying, you know, "Daddy, maybe Herman could do something about it." And Herman looked over and said, "Well, I might be able to invent something to make the job a little bit easier." And he said, "Well, that would be wonderful if you could." And he said, "I think I'll just go to work on it." And he went to work on it, and he spent years, up to 1890, working on this. And here, what he came up with is this idea. He used the adding machine and the typewriter inventions, because these are punch cards, and these were the way the first computers worked. They tabulated, in this case, the census. They would have people like, "Are you in an age group 10 to 20, 20 to 30, 30 to 40? And they'd punch a hole, whichever one you were. And then they'd get, "Are you," they'd have male or female. They were primitive. They only had two sexes back then, male and female. And then they'd go down the list of all of these different things, occupations. And then they'd put everybody's information on a card, and then they'd put it into the computer, and then it would process all of that information for 50 million some cards, or in the case of the 1890 census, 62 million, and then it would come up with the totals, and it didn't have to take 10 years to do it. This is such a wonderful story. Herman Hollerith invents the computer. He later sells out to IBM, and he's just a hero in American technology, an inventor. What happens? We get the typewriter, the adding machine, the computer.
Read it. Works. Freedom works.
Freedom works. We had a free economy. We could do all we had to. It was nobody. Well, let's give somebody a subsidy to invent the computer. They'd still be working on it. It would not be invented. But we turn Herman Hollerith loose. I wish I could just move on and say, and that's the story. I have to say a little bit about Kate and Herman. He got so preoccupied with his computer that Kate got tired of waiting and married someone else. But Herman did get the computer. He lost Kate, but he got the computer, and what he hoped would be his father-in-law ended up just being absolutely elated with Herman. And he said, "I always knew I could trust that guy. He was good." And so we have the invention of the computer. Now, what do we have here? We've got this is pretty good array of entrepreneurship and inventions. We've got the typewriter, we've got the adding machine and the computer, and they all kind of go together. And office work and everything is tremendously speeded up. Now let's go to some others. I want to talk about an entrepreneur who was bigger, perhaps, than all of those put together. When he was 6 years old, he went to school in Ohio. And he was dyslexic. He couldn't pronounce. He kind of read a little bit backwards. And he was kind of ADHD, too. And his mom had to take him out of school. And he never went to the public schools after that, ever. I mean, at college, That was his total school experience. When he was 12, he had some illnesses, and we think it caused the deafness. He was completely deaf in one ear and hard of hearing in the other ear. So here we have a guy, never went to school, he's ADHD, he's dyslexic, he's no hearing in one ear, hard of hearing in the other ear, and he loves music. And he says, is that going to stop me? Well, it did kind of stop him from playing an instrument. But it doesn't stop me from inventing something so that I can listen to music. He invented something that all of a sudden, for the first time in human history, people could listen to music anytime they wanted. We take it for granted, right? I pull up a song and I'm listening and I'm walking to class or something. You know, we just so take it for granted. We had none of this. He invents the phonograph. He's deaf. He's virtually deaf and he invents the phonograph. Who am I speaking of? Does anybody know? I hear it? Yeah, say it louder. Thomas Edison. And I mean, he even invented a hearing aid. He had 1,093 patents. But I mean, the most important weren't even the phonograph. The electric light bulb, I mean, making electricity available to us. Don't you like that electricity coming down on us there, giving me light? And we have the development and discovery and uses of electricity. And also he invented film studios. He started the first studio for filmmaking. He invented the film technology. Not bad for a virtually deaf person who's ADHD and never went to school. But how can this happen? It's because he had the chance. You know, he didn't have to listen to somebody say, you can't do it. His parents were very encouraging. His dad was an immigrant. But, he was very encouraging to Thomas. His dad was a jack of all trades, could do all sorts of things. He said, Thomas, you can do it too. He had a family that encouraged him and cared about him and told him he could do it. And this guy becomes maybe the greatest inventor in the history of the world. Not bad for our period of the late 1800s. The period of the late 1800s is sometimes called the Gilded Age. Gilded being, referring to wealth and that kind of thing. It's a great time period, and he epitomized by Edison. I know some of you are thinking, he's out of gas now. No, I'm not. There is more. If it were just that, it would be impressive. Am I not right? I mean, phonograph, light bulb, films, and then computer, adding machine typewriter. This is a pretty good batch of inventions. But there is more to come. The next person may not have had it quite as bad as Thomas Edison, but he came from a poor family. His mother died when he was 11 years old, and he was on a farm, and he hated farming, and he was trained in mechanical ability, a machinist. And he was in Michigan and moved. It's interesting how the Midwest is involved in a lot of this. He moved to Detroit and as a teenager and began working for Thomas Edison in his light company there in Detroit. And by day, he worked for Edison. And at night, he spent 7 years in his rented garage trying to perfect the automobile. Right? I think any guesses who this is going to be? Henry Ford. Never went to college, never went to school. He got out of school as quickly as possible. I know this is discouraging. He says everybody who's successful didn't go to school. Well, school is, listen, I'm a college professor. I can't be too negative. I think that there's value in this. I am merely saying this. You can't allow somebody else to define you by what you haven't done. You cannot allow other people, and they didn't. Edison refused to have people, hey, you're deaf, you can't do anything. He invents the phonograph. Ford's mother, who was 12 years old when his mother died. In the year before she died, she said, he took a clock apart and re-put it back together, reassembled it. She said, Henry, you're a natural born mechanic. I wish she could have seen him on the car. Now, it was primitive. It was primitive. The tires were bicycle tires. It was in this garage, which was a brick garage, and he finally, after 7 years, got the engine in and got the whole thing up and running in the 1890s. And he was so excited, and then he realized the car wouldn't fit through the garage door. So he had to get a hammer and an axe and was whacking the garage door of his rented garage. And then the next door lady was a nuisance person. You know, oh, that Henry Ford, what's he doing now? And she calls up the guy who owns the garage. He comes in, and by that time, Ford has broken open a hole and can get his, what he called his quadricycle. He had a quadricycle, and the guy was so, oh my gosh, what? You know, he forgot about his garage. And he got to be the one who held the lantern while Henry Ford drove his quadricycle 3 miles an hour down the streets of Detroit. It was a primitive start, but when he went on to get the assembly line worked out, see, Ford had the vision of a car in every garage. And everybody else, when you asked them, what do you want in the way of transportation? They said, we want faster horses for our carriages. We want better shock absorbers for the carriage so it doesn't bump so much when we go through the streets. Everybody who was asked, how can I improve technology of transportation, said, faster horses, carriages with better shock absorbers. Henry Ford said, car. And he could not get loans. He spent a lot of time trying to get loans. When he finally did get some loans and developed the assembly line and began to have people, because you could make a car. Henry Ford said, if I sit down and work on a car, I can make a car in about one day. But if I get this assembly line going, and that you have people at different ends, somebody putting the tires on, somebody putting the steering wheel on, and you've got all this, and you've got them repeatedly coming down the line, we can get dozens and dozens of cars made. Hundreds of cars. Because see, he's thinking a car in every garage. Nobody else is even thinking of it as a mode of transportation. And so what happens is that with all of this thoughtfulness by Henry Ford trying to work this thing out, he gets the assembly line, but then people who work on the assembly line get bored. I mean, what's your name? John. John from Alabama. Supporting Alabama. What would happen if your job was to put a steering wheel on a car every day and you did that 8 hours a day every day? Get pretty sore, pretty tired, pretty bored. A lot of people were not showing up for work. What happens when you don't show up for work and you're on the assembly line? What happens to the assembly line? This is where Henry Ford, listen, the courage. A lot of time, entrepreneurship and inventiveness, it takes a good idea, but you have to have the courage to follow it to its completion. It broke down, and a lot of people said, there, I showed you it wouldn't work. And Henry Ford said, I've got another idea. And he doubled the average payday. It would be, in today's terms, about $110 a day as opposed to $60 a day. For a worker. He said, I'm going to pay people tremendously. It was called the five, then it was $5. $5 then could buy what over $100 does today. It was called the $5 day. And he said, I will give workers that money. And their job is to be there on time, work efficiently, don't make mistakes, and you'll keep your job. And then he rotated them around to different jobs. The point is, he worked out a system that was able to hold together by doing all the. Now, I know some of you are thinking, see, people said, well, how can you double the wages and make it a business work? And he said, it's simple. Because he said, furthermore, I'm going to cut the price of the car. He cut the price of the car. The car in today's dollars was about $16,000. The first ones he was producing, $16,000. He got it down to $6,000. And he said, I'm going to keep cutting the price of his Model T car. I'm going to keep cutting the price and raising the wages. And he ended up saying, because every time I cut the price of my car $1, I get 1,000 new customers. I reach the level where I can get more customers because I can afford it. You can't put a car in every garage if every garage and the person who owns that garage can't afford to buy a car to put it in there. Ford's genius was, it was a simple car. I mean, it was simple as in gas tank, no gas gauge. How do I know how much gas I have? Oh, you lift this up. Oh, yeah, okay. It looks like there's about half a tank left. Okay, I'll go on. I mean, it's simplicity. But that simplicity allowed the sales of millions and millions. Over half the cars out on the streets were Model Ts. Henry Ford became the second billionaire in U.S. history. Billionaire. From that, never went to school. His mother dies when he's 12. He works manual labor. Now, I get some people, I know geniuses are sometimes goofballs. I mean, he wouldn't eat sugar. And he said, why won't you eat sugar? He says, because the crystals might cut my stomach open. Right? But we don't study him because he's a sugar expert. Right? He didn't get that. He wouldn't eat chicken because chickens ate bugs. That's what he said. I mean, he's wildly eccentric, but the thing is, he had the freedom to be silly, but he had the freedom to invent. No other country was coming up with these kinds of inventions. And all those other countries would say, well, we are going to have the government give money to help somebody invent it. Or they would say, this wealthy person, like the Rolls-Royce was developed over in Britain by these very educated people. Well, it's a great car, but it's not exactly affordable to put in every garage. Henry Ford, they earned a modest sum with the Rolls-Royce. Henry Ford becomes a billionaire making Model Ts. He gives you something you want. He gives you something you can afford. He changed the way Americans dealt with the issue of transportation. I have one more that I ought to do. The airplane. The airplane. Invented by the Wright brothers. Are you ready for another common refrain here? They never went to college. They were bicycle mechanics from Ohio. Ohio seems to be doing pretty well in the inventions here. But they did their exploration or their flight tests in North Carolina. But they operated a bicycle repair shop in Dayton, Ohio. And in the winter months, they'd go to North Carolina and test their airplane. And everybody said it would never work. In fact, the government had decided maybe we ought to subsidize somebody because we have to invent the airplane or other countries will get it and then they'll drop bombs on us. So here we had stopped subsidizing people for all those years. And then we thought maybe we ought to subsidize somebody. And so we subsidized a guy named Samuel Langley who had written a book called Experiments in Aerodynamics. And he did a toy plane across the Potomac River. And they said, well, just build a bigger one and do it. He had a theory that the way you fly is you have a real big engine, you have a catapult, you shoot the plane up into the air, the engine then takes over and goes straight. And he had a pilot who had a compass sewn onto his leg so he could see where he was going. And he took the government money and he went up in the air on the Potomac, his pilot, Woo! Crash right into the ground, or into the Potomac, into the river. Then people said, wait, what's this? And he says, minor mistake, let me try again. So we had him the money to try again, and it goes whoosh. The New York Times said, this business of flight is so complicated that even geniuses like Samuel Langley can't figure it out. And it's going to be at least, if we get all the mathematicians working together, we might be able to do it in a million years. Well, I'm going to be leaving in a while on an airplane. So it wasn't a million years after 1903 that that happened. It was, in fact, about 3 months after 1903 that the Wright brothers, using completely different methods, ended up flying the first airplane in world history. Now, we have a judgment here. This is an opinion. When you look at these inventions, and I want to be open for questions here in just a minute. When you look at all these inventions, typewriter, batting machine, and computer, and then you go from that to Edison with his light bulb and with the phonograph and films, and then Ford with the car and the Wright brothers with the airplane, all within a 40-year period. I mean, imagine that. You all are like 16 years old, say, give or take a few years. Imagine in 40 years to have, you're 56, I mean, you can still go strong, and you've got those kinds of inventions ahead of you. I mean, this was amazing to people who were living at the time. To them, they'd say, the world has just completely changed all around us with all these. It may be the greatest period of inventions in human history. I can't think of another 40-year period, including the last 40 years. And I mean, we had some great ones, right? And maybe I'm wrong. I mean, but I think that, actually, this is built on a lot of what was done there, right? Adding machines, music, and all that. You have to have these people doing these kinds of inventions. This may be the greatest period of human invention and entrepreneurship in human history. And it was done because
freedom works.
We did it without the government intervention. Let's have some questions. Yeah. Let's do it.
All righty, ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much, Dr. Folsom. If you have any questions, please line up back here. And
yeah.
Looks like we've got our first
question. Go for it.
Hi, my name is Lucy Hickey. I'm from California. So I was wondering, which particular invention or inventor do you think had the biggest impact in the making of like our modern world? And also, which inventor had the most remarkable and inspiring backstory that we can look up to?
Those are good questions. You're nice to ask me. It's a subjective opinion. I put Edison first. Now, you ask which inventor has the most inspiring story? In some ways, I put yet another inventor in this period with having an even more inspiring story, and that would be John D. Rockefeller. John D. Rockefeller, and I have a chapter in Myth of the Robber Barons on both James J. Hill, who built the Transcontinental without subsidies, and then Rockefeller. Rockefeller made oil something that was usable for energy. And he did it because he was able to figure out that everything in a barrel of oil was useful. And so he would work with the byproducts, the gas, the kerosene for lighting lamps and that kind of thing. And his backstory is that his father was he had parents, but his father left him periodically and ended up being a bigamist and lived with and married another woman and was gone. He would periodically reappear and pay some bills. And the mother at home, his mother, had to feed and dress the whole family. Everybody said the Rockefeller children were walking around in tatters. He had illegitimate children who were born by him, not by his wife, in that same community. It was a totally, and the way she got to, he says, John, your father has not been a good father, but you have a father who is, will never let you down, and that's God. And Rockefeller said, I'm going to try that and see if God is all that, what he seems to be. And he ended up, he said, I mean, it says, given it shall be given unto you. Oh yeah, I'm just going to give all my stuff here. And he ends up the first billionaire in U.S. history. A remarkable story of somebody, a comeback, also didn't go to college. Somebody who, I think his backstory is one of the most fascinating stories, but I like Edison's backstory too. But so thank you for your question.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Michael Clinton. I go to Veritas Collegiate Academy, and I really enjoyed your speech.
Thank you.
I just had a question. So you mentioned that all of these, or most of these inventors hadn't gone to college or hadn't pursued much like of education. Would you say that's despite, despite them going to college, they still, or them not going to college, they still invented these things? Or it's because of them not going to
college? You're raising good questions. How do we fit the college in? College is good. See, you know, I mean, I taught for decades and still didn't get back in. Here's what I've discovered in my own teaching and with my colleagues. We tend to teach what we know to be true, and we tend to back off when it comes to really being innovative and creative and coming up with new ideas. And it's hard to grade people, because how do you get in a class and you say, okay, everybody, I want somebody to invent the automobile, right? I mean, you know what I mean? In other words, we tend to test on what is known. You can't test on what is not known because it's not known. But if you're going to be tested on what's known rather than what's not known, your mind is going to be settled completely on what's known. And at least a lot of your mind ought to be centered on that. And you're not going to be turning your mind to what can be done to improve it, because there's no what can we do to improve it that's going to get a good grade. Imagine coming up to your teacher, I've got a way you can improve your lectures. Boy, he'll be glad to hear that, won't he? You know, the ideas you presented, I just read some things and I think they're wrong, and you can upgrade them. Do you follow me? There's an entrenched, you go to college and you learn good things, I hope. In, you know, law school, there are things that are good. But it does not encourage very much creativity. And every time in my classroom when I tried to encourage creativity, sometimes it worked a little bit, but I'd always say, okay, you know, you have so many pages, and I would try to write, think up a way that you could do this a little differently. And students would come up, some, well, I don't know where, I don't know, how do I think, you know, and then some would come up with just off the wall stuff. And I thought, I'm not sure you can teach this. I'm not sure you can teach it. But if you don't go to college, you don't know, you're not intimidated by that. Your mind is not confronted with all this stuff that's known, and you're thinking, oh good, I know now what's known, and I will go out and I will know it so well that people will hire me to know the rules and the laws. But these guys were thinking, this is inefficient, how can I do something that's better? As a professor, I want to give them Ford and Edison A's in the schoolwork they never took. They get an A for me, at least. And they don't have to take the final exam either. And I've never had students who I gave A's without taking the final exam. Those two get A's, and they already, in effect, completed the final exam with what they accomplished.
Thank you so
much. That's such a good question. I mean, I think we all need to think of that. And I may not be complete on that, but it's worth pondering. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Yeah. Good morning. My name is Zachary Brown. I just recently graduated from Covenant Catholic High School.
Okay.
So you talked about creativity in the college classroom and, you know, things like that. So I was wondering, how do you bring creativity to, like, the younger generations in your own, like, small communities? So, like, you know, children these days are stuck on their iPads and phones with, like, stunted creativity. They don't have to, like, think creatively anymore. So how do you bring that back into your small communities, your family, and life?
Listen, I don't have the answers. I can ask some of the questions, as you just did. One thing, though, I've noticed, you know, with having kids of my own, all kids who are 5 years old are artists, and they all please mommy and daddy with their pictures. And it isn't until they're 10 years old and 90% of them have been told, your drawings are wretched, that they give up and do something else. I'm not saying that all of them are artists and should keep drawing, but I'm just saying there needs to be a way to encourage creativity, and school is not a very good place for it. And courage is another thing. Courage is something like Ford to sit there and do that assembly line and pay the wage. Everybody was criticizing. He raises the wages for the workers. Listen, these people were good on black Americans. Ford could not hire enough black Americans for his assembly line. He'd hire handicapped people to work on nuts and bolts. Do the nuts and bolts and get them all in, and then we'll bring them into the assembly line and have somebody attach them into the car. He wanted to help him. Rockefeller was so interested in helping black Americans. He says, listen, I had a father who deserted. I know what it's like to be down and out. I want to help. He started, he gave to Tuskegee Institute because they had such a creative entrepreneur, George Washington Carver, a black man on their faculty. And then he said, wait a minute, I'm giving to black colleges that are men. There's no black women's college. And so he started Spelman College for black women and named it after his wife, Laura, Laura Spelman. And so he's saying, I'm giving at least people a chance. I mean, college isn't the only thing, as we've been saying here, but I'm giving, at least you can learn stuff and you can know stuff and maybe be not lose all your creativity in the process. How do you think we might encourage people to be creative?
Well, I think it starts in the home. So, like,
okay,
when you have your own children, I said, like, everyone's stuck on their iPads these days and their kids are on their phones all the time. So, like, you go to a restaurant and you'll see those families, everybody's on their phones or iPads. So take away that, like, you get to a point where you have to give them some form of communication, but, like, not until you're like high school. I feel like I didn't get my phone till last year.
So you think this stifles creativity?
Yeah, definitely. I mean,
a lot of people have been saying, I don't know. Yeah,
I would say so. Because, I mean, you have everything at your hands. You don't need to do anything. You don't need to create anything. That's all your entertainment. I mean, like I said, I didn't get my phone till last year. I'm like, I was working on board games freshman year. Gabe can tell you. He was a tester for all those. Definitely enjoyed that. So,
okay.
Yeah. So that's not, I mean, that stifles creativity the most, I'd say, or hinders it at a young age. So take that back and then just encourage your kids. Don't put them down when they do something wrong. Encourage them to make mistakes and keep going with that.
Thank you for your comments.
Yeah, absolutely. Questions? Thank you very much.
Sure. Do we have anybody here who kind of thinks you sort of feel entrepreneurial talents to invent, you know, and develop and market? I don't see. Oh, good. Good, I want you to succeed. You know, that's interesting. I'm just thinking out loud now because I thought, how many plan to go to college? How many are going to be inventors and entrepreneurs? Yeah, and I think it's good. See, I went to college, and I teach college, and I think it has value. But the creativity part of it is where I'm stumped. Yes, go ahead.
All righty, Dr. Folsom, we have one final question here.
The final question. Go ahead.
Hi, Dr. Folsom. I'm Maylee Luna, and I recently graduated from Divine Savior Holy Angels Catholic High School in Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
Okay.
I'm a huge history buff, so I really enjoyed your speech, but a lot of my friends back home, like, absolutely, like, hate anything that has to do with our history and, like, with learning history at all. What's your best piece of advice for us history buffs when we're trying to convince our friends that learning history is an important aspect of life, and it's, like, what shaped our society?
I tell you what, come up here, just a minute. I'm going to give you a book that I wrote, FDR Goes to War, and I tried to be creative. I have something in here, in this book, that I've never put that I've never seen in any book before. Let me just read this. Franklin Roosevelt was stifling innovation with government programs during his New Deal. And he, in order to fund the programs, he suggested an income tax of 100% on wealthy people. In fact, he made it 100.6%. If you earned $1 million, you had to pay all million plus 6,000 to the government. I don't see any creative outbursts. You know, remember when we did Freedom Works? How about outburst?
Outburst.
Good. I'm glad we had an outburst. Listen to what, let me see here. Here is what Senator Alfred Chandler from Kentucky said to the 100.6% tax. All of us owe the government, we owe it for everything we have, and that obligation, on the basis of that obligation, the government can take everything we have if the government needs it. The government can assert its right to have all the taxes it needs for any purpose, either now or at any time in the future.
Outburst.
Thank you. We had some creative, take that, and I hope you can work with that FDR in World War II and do something creative. Have a creative plan that will reduce taxes. Do something good.
I'm going to political science next.
Oh, so perfect.
Thank you.
Now, that quote is in no other book or no lecture that I have ever heard. Do you think that something, a fact like that might be useful to know? That there were people actually supporting it and it almost became law? People ask me, are you discouraged? No, first, because I like seeing young people here who believe that freedom works. And second, because I've seen it worse. We don't have 100.6% tax. That's the neat thing about being old is that you get to say, wait a minute, there's actually been stuff that's worse than what's happening now. And then you can sit there and say, we can overcome this with a little creative energy and good work and an understanding of history. This is where college is important. If we could teach what works and what doesn't work, we would discover that
freedom works.
Yeah, thank you.